Hi everyone, in this video we're going to go through a workflow using the Substance 3D and Hair3D tools to realize the complete texturing and modeling of real-time hair as well as facial hair using procedural methods only. The terms procedural or parametric mean the textures or geometry are generated by the tools in a dynamic way and we can modify many generation parameters non-destructively. It also enables to reuse already made designs and obtain new ones by only modifying a few parameters. In Substance 3D Painter, we'll go through the creation of a hair scalp texture and see how to project it on the head texture. We'll use parametric eyebrows and eyelashes and we'll create haircut textures procedurally, all in Painter. Then in Substance 3D Stager, we'll create the haircut geometry and assign a parametric hair material to it so we can modify both the geometry and the texturing properties live in Stager. The head model and textures used in this video have been kindly provided by 3D.sk. This is a scanned and retopologized model, ready to be used with all the associated PBR textures. Let's begin in Blender with the 3D models we're going to use. This is the head and eye models from 3D.sk, and I added meshes to support eyelashes. We'll be using a plane in the scene to lay out our haircut textures. The plane could be made in an independent scene, but having them together with the head model will enable a nice feature in Painter that we'll discuss later. Finally, I derived an intermediate scalp mesh from the head mesh by selecting a section of the head mesh and extracting it as a separate mesh. The UVs on the scalp mesh are clean without split. If we compare the scalp UVs to the head UVs, we can see the latter has a split on the top of the head. Using a separate scalp mesh will enable us to generate a procedural scalp texture that will be adaptable to any head mesh regardless of its UVs. The scalp mesh is just intermediate though. It is not part of the final scene. We will project the texture generated with it onto the head mesh using the warp projection of Painter. So in the end, the scalp texture will be part of the head texture. We'll also size the scalp mesh a little larger than the head so it is visible above it within Painter. Now let's go into Painter to generate the textures we'll need. We'll begin with the scalp texture made using Hair3D Surface Hair Edition. For this, we'll first define a few masks which will drive the hair generator. The first one is called the hair mask and basically tells where hair should be generated. Here I painted in white the outline of the hair mask on a specific channel, then used a filter to fill up the inside of the shape and a warp filter to make the outline a little jaggy. Then we'll set up the direction mask on the normal channel. This one drives the hair direction. We could paint it, but here we're using a procedural tool to define the main direction curves. Using a procedural tool here has several advantages, such as the ability to easily modify directions, use direction mirroring, so we only need to define directions on one side of the head, and we'll also use a fill-up filter to expand the directions uniformly throughout the whole texture space. Then we'll use a Hair3D surface generator to generate the hair, providing it with the masks made earlier. We can see the hair are shorter on the front because this design actually uses a third mask, which is the growth mask. It enables to define areas where hair will be longer or shorter based on the mask grayness level. Again, we can either paint this mask or use a procedural generator. We can modify various settings of the generator, such as the amount of hair, the way they are distributed, their thickness, length, orientation, their shape, and many others. Then we'll use another hair generator to generate longer hair on the top. This part will be covered by hair cards later. I used the layer mask to define where this additional layer will be visible, and also to mark a slight separation at the location the hair cards will be placed. The next step is to project the scalp texture on the head texture. For this, we'll first export the scalp textures. Then we'll re-import them into Painter and assign them to a fill layer configured in a warp projection mode. Using the warp projection tools, we can align the scalp texture on the head mesh the way we want. And the scalp mesh is no more necessary at this point, unless we wish to make modifications to the generated hair. Now we'll add the eyebrows and eyelashes. We're going to use Hair3D Surface Facial Hair Edition for these. It comes with a collection of predefined procedural designs we can modify with various parameters. We'll drag the parametric material using the Alt key to make it a decal on the head mesh. From there, we can scale and position it using the gizmo controls. We can choose between different styles and make various modifications, such as changing the shape, the hair density, the hair length, disorder, and many others. To make the second eyebrow, we only need to duplicate the decal, mirror it, position it, and change a variation parameter in order to have a unique design which is not identical to the previous one. We can even add cuts if we wish to. The eyelashes follow the same principle. We alt-drag the parametric material on the eyelash mesh. We can choose among the predefined designs and make various modifications. Now let's move on to the haircut part. We'll begin by creating the haircut textures inside Painter, and we'll use the plane we included into the scene for this. The haircuts are made using HairTG cards, which is currently under development and enables to define procedurally both the haircut textures and geometry. The way we create the haircut textures is simple. In the Painter layer stack, we first add a specific generator called the controller that will drive some common characteristics to all the haircuts at once. Then we use a single design generator per haircut texture. In the final tool, there will be many predefined designs for users to start from, but I'll show you here quickly how haircut textures can be made. So we have strands, which are groups of hair that we can 3D position with the control points within the texture space. Hair within these strands can be either single hair or threads, which are another hair grouping level to add thickness and to group the hair tightly together. From there, we have dozens of shaping and aspect defining parameters, such as setting up the width at various control point levels, adding waves, shortening various parts of the design, fade the hair at the root, tip, or on the sides, and many others. When we're done with one design, we scale it down and position it within the texture that will hold all the designs. We can then duplicate our cut texture to create another one. We just need to change a variation slider to have a random variant that we can modify further at will. Since our cards are linked to the same controller, we can change some aspects of all the cards from there at once. For example, the hair thickness, add or remove waves, enable other maps, and so on. Once our card textures are set up, we have two options. Either we export them as textures so we can reuse them in another context, or we build a parametric material from them. HairTG cards will enable to export your parametric settings from Painter in order to build a parametric material that you'll be able to reuse either in Painter or in Stager. And this is what we'll be using in Stager, as we'll see next. In Stager, we will create our haircut 3D model. For this, we'll use a parametric model that will just drop into our scene. This parametric model generates a set of haircuts that can be configured in many ways. We can generate multiple variations of the card layout. We can define the amount of cards to lay out vertically and horizontally. We can control the card length and width, and we can bend the support they're generated on in various ways. We can also visualize the support alone, so it makes it easier to position it on the head model, for example. And we can visualize both the support and the cards on it. We can shape the cards in various ways with several deformation sections and effects, such as twisting. This way, we can build a full hair model using several of these hair model units placed at various locations on the head mesh. Each set of card can have its own support shape to adapt to the head shape at a specific location. Another feature is the smart mirror, enabling to design cards on one side of the head only for areas which are symmetrical. The smart part is that the mirrored section is distinct from the original. Its distribution of cards is different, ensuring one side doesn't look similar to the other besides its overall shape. Now that our cards are in place, let's see how we assign a parametric hair material to them. We begin to drag our haircut texture material on one haircut model. As we can see, the UVs are not being defined yet, so we'll do this now. For this, we're going to change the output of the card model so it generates a single card. It accepts at most 4 different card textures, which can be UV'd independently. We can then set up the UV scale and position for the first card. Then we'll move to the next and repeat the operation. When done, we enable again the multicard output, and here's the result with 2 card textures being used randomly over the card set. Since we can copy and paste card models, we don't need to make these UV assignments for each of the model units. We can do it for the base models, and then we create copies of them with the UVs already set up. Now, let's assign the parametric hair material on the cards placed on our head mesh. These have been UV'd already, so we only need to assign the material. Since we've placed all the hair card models under a same group, we can just drop the material in the group and this will assign it to all the models inside. The same material instance will be used for all the units, which means when we make a modification to the material assigned to one card model, this change is taken into account for all the other card models the material has been assigned to. Now we'll configure the material, enable the normal and roughness maps, change the color, let's see how it looks with the different hair thickness and with some waves. Another method to assign the same material to multiple objects is to use the sampler tool. Here I've hidden all the card models except one, so we don't have overlapping, which helps for selection. We assign the material to one object and use the sampler tool to sample this material. We just click on the object we want to sample the material of. Then we can shift-click on other objects, and this will link the sampled material to them. In the end, we have a single material instance, as seen earlier, so making material modifications on one object is echoed to all the others. Now we'll browse through several variations of the textures and select a camera for rendering. One last thing we'll cover in this workflow is the export of the hair model and how to use it inside Painter, along with the procedural hair texturing. To export the hair from Stager, we select the group where the hair models are, then go Export Selected. This will merge all the hair card models into a single hair mesh, as we can see here in Blender. From there, we can incorporate this hair mesh into the scene we were using in Painter, and reload the new scene in Painter through the Project Configuration menu. Let's go back for a moment to the plane we used in Painter to define our hair card textures. The project I am using here is slightly different from the one used earlier, but this is just to illustrate how we can control the hair textures directly on the hair model. So on this plane we built a set of card textures, and we had a controller we could use to modify them all at once. If you remember, at the beginning of the workflow I mentioned we could use a plane inside our scene instead of a separate project. And this is why. This layer stack we built for the plane, we're going to copy it and paste it into the hair mesh layer stack now. Then we can use this same set of layers to further control the hair texture's properties, but this time directly on the hair model. And when Painter will support parametric models, we should be able to control the hair model directly from there as well. Thank you for watching, and if you want to know more about this process and the tools involved, please check the description below the video and you'll find several links.